So hello everybody, welcome to the second video of the tuberculosis series. And I must warn you, this is essentially a very factual portion, but there are important applied concepts from our first video as well. So it's important that you have watched that video before moving on to the onto this video. Okay, so let's begin. First, we have to deal with a few general characteristics of the mycobacterial genus. I've discussed a few of them in the first video as well, but over here, just for clarity's sake, these are gram-positive rods which have a complex lipid-rich cell wall. I hope you remember the cell wall as well, the structure of the cell wall, and these two important things, that is the surface proteins and the lipoarabinomannan protein. Okay, these two will come in handy when we move on to the diagnosis portion. Okay, and we have to remember that these are non-motile, non-sporing, and non-capsulated bacilli, which are strict aerobes and are microaerophilic. Okay, but the most important property that we have to discuss here is the property of acid fastness. Okay, so what is this concept of acid fast? So it was introduced by Paul Ehrlich, and it was modified by Zeal and Nielsen. Over here, we give a primary stain to the bacilli, and that is carbyl fission. Carbyl fission is just a mixture of basic fission in phenol. We have to heat it. Okay, then after applying the carbyl fission, we have to add a decolorizer. Earlier, we used to use this 20% sulfuric acid, but now we most commonly use 3% acid alcohol, that is 3% hydrochloric acid and 95% ethanol. And following application of the decolorizer, we have to apply the counter stain. The counter stain is most commonly, which we use, is methylene blue. We can also use malachite green or picric acid. The decolorizer, in case of the decolorizer, we can also use acetone. Okay. Now, the thing is that an acid-fast bacilli, due to the presence of the mycolic acid in the cell wall, will not take up their counter stain. Okay. That is, they are not being decolorized by the acid, and hence they are acid-fast. That is, they are not taking up that acid as well. And the non-acid-fast bacilli, after being decolorized by sulfuric acid or any other decolorizer which we are using, will take up the counter stain. Okay, so that's the important concept over here. So this Zeal and Nielsen stain has been modified a bit as well. Okay, when you're asked about the modifications of Zeal and Nielsen staining, we often jump to something known as the Kinyon or Gabbett stain, but it's not so. A modification of the Zeal and Nielsen stain is this, that is, we use different concentrations of the decolorizer. That is, we use 0.5 to 1% or 5% or 0.25 to 0.5% of sulfuric acid. Anyways, first we have to learn that which bacilli are acid fast with 20% sulfuric acid. Of course, all the members of the Mycobacterium tuberculosis complex, as well as the atypical mycobacteria. For atypical mycobacteria, there is a Runyon's classification which is very important, and you have to learn that by heart, okay, because important short note may be asked from there, and is commonly asked in your Viva as well. Anyway, the acid fast with less than 20% sulfuric acid is the modified Zeal and Nielsen staining, and under that, first we have acid fast with 5% sulfuric acid. So with 5% sulfuric acid, we have Mycobacterium leprae, an oocyst of Cyclospora, Cryptosporidium, and Isospora. These are all parasites, and these are very important because they cause diarrhea in AIDS. Okay, so commonly means, I think in the year 2019 there was a question about diarrhea in an AIDS patient. Okay, so when you're asked about the diagnosis in such a case, you shouldn't just stop at the diagnosis of HIV. You should move on and offer a diagnosis of these as well. And the diagnosis of these is acid fast staining of stool sample. Okay, using this concentration of decolorizer. So please remember this. Okay. And nevertheless, let's move on to 0.5 to 1% H2SO4 acid fast. And these are Nocardia, Rhodococcus, Legionella mcdacei, and Tinea saginata oocysts. This Tinea saginata oocysts, which is acid fast with 0.5 to 1% H2SO4, is a favorite question of the examiners, okay, during Viva. And finally, acid fast with 0.5 to 0.5% sulfuric acid. These are bacterial spores and head of sperm. Okay. So please remember, this is very important. This modification of Zeeland-Ingels staining is definitely going to be asked during your viva. Okay. And along with it, the names of the Mycobacterium tuberculosis complex members. Okay. So this is your typical microscopic picture after your acid phase bacilli staining. You can see these red bacilli against a blue background. Okay. And these are the latest RNTCP guidelines for examination of sputum smear for acid phase bacilli. If there are more than 10 bacilli present per oil immersion field, we give it a grade 3+. If it's 1 to 10, we give it a grade of 2+. If 10 to 99 bacilli are present per 100 oil immersion fields, then we give it a grade of 1+. If 1 to 9 bacilli are present per 100 oil immersion fields, then we give the grading scanty. And if no acid phase bacilli are found even in 100 oil immersion fields, then the grading is nil. This portion is commonly asked in your viva. That is the number of oil field immersion that we have to examine before giving the grading. Okay, so for 3+ we have to examine 20 oil fields. For 2+, 50 oil immersion fields. For 1+, 100 oil immersion fields. For scanty, again 100 oil immersion fields. And before labeling it as nil, we have to examine 100 oil immersion fields. So this is a very important table. Again, we have to memorize this by heart. Okay. So before moving on to the RNTCP diagnostic guidelines, we first have to learn about the microscopy. Okay. So the various diagnostic modalities we have to learn first, and among them the first we have to learn about is the microscopy. So it's cheap and rapid, and we commonly use the Zeeland-Ingels staining or the Kinnune and Gabbett or Spold stain. Okay. So it's just a few changes which have been applied to the Zeeland-Ingels staining method. Over here, we do not heat the carbolfustian, and we increase the phenol concentration as well, and we increase the exposure time as well. So you must have read it in your microbiology practical classes, 8 to 10 minutes, 1 to 2 minutes, 5 minutes, these time. So we just have to increase the exposure time for carbolfustian. Okay. And what we have to remember that it has a very low sensitivity, that is, it can detect bacilli only if there are more than 10 to the power 4 bacilli present per ml of sputum. Okay. However, it has a very, very high positive predictive value. You'll learn about these terminologies when you move on to community medicine, but essentially, positive predictive value means that if a test comes positive, what is the chance that I have the disease? Okay. So that is known as positive predictive value, and it has a this microscopy has a very high positive predictive value, but albeit on very low sensitivity. Okay. Also, in place of the acid phase staining, we can also give fluorescent dyes. Fluorescent dyes we can use oramine O or rhodamine B, which bind to the mycolic acid. It has a better sensitivity than acid phase bacilli, but obviously less than blood culture, sputum culture, which is obviously the gold standard in case of tuberculosis diagnosis. It can also be done in a very less time. However, we find no difference between, or we can observe no difference between dead and live bacilli when we do a fluorescent dye examination of sputum smear. Okay, so that's a very important thing, that it offers no distinction between dead and live bacilli. So let's move on to the culture, which is sputum culture and the most important diagnostic modality in case of tuberculosis. So before we jump into the culture, we need to know that we have to homogenize and decontaminate the sputum sample. Okay, and for this we use what is known as the Petrov's method. Okay, so we take the sputum sample in a test tube. We add 4% NaOH in it. We shake it for 20 minutes at a temperature of around 37 degrees Celsius. Then we put it in a centrifuge and give it a whirl at 3000 RPM for 20 minutes. Then we take the lower 1 ml sediment and we give N by 10 HCl. Finally, this is the sample which we will culture on inoculate. other techniques which we can use for homogenization or decontamination is cetyl pyridine chloride, We can use this in place of NaOH and HCl combination, or we can give N-acetylcysteine and 2% NaOH, or we can give zephyrine. Zephyrine is basically benzyl alkonium chloride, or we can just use NaOH or cetrimide, or we can use mineral acids like 3% HCl, or we can use 5% oxalic acid. Okay, so these are other techniques which we can use to homogenize and decontaminate the sputum sample. However, the WHO recommended technique is the Petrov's method. Okay, now like I said, sputum culture is the gold standard examination and it has a sensitivity of around 10 to 100 bacilli per L, so a very high sensitivity. The bacilli have a generation time of 14 to 15 hours. Okay, now generation time refers to a time taken by the bacilli to double its colonies. Okay, it doesn't necessitate that after 14 to 15 hours you get a result. Technically, colonies will be visible after 6 to 8 weeks, which is the major disadvantage of this culture, that it takes a long time and you can't wait 6 to 8 weeks before instituting therapy. During that time, he or she will infect a whole the group of people. Okay, so that's the main disadvantage of the culture technique. You have to remember, like I said before, there is a strict aerobe and 0.5% glycerol and sodium pyruvate. These two things will enhance the growth of the MTB bacilli. Okay, so in many culture media, we add glycerol and sodium pyruvate to enhance the growth and perhaps to give the results in a faster time. Okay, so now let's move on to the culture media. So they are broadly classified into solid and liquid media, and the solid media again can be classified into egg containing and non-egg containing media. Okay, so the egg containing media are, first of all, LJ media. The LJ medium is commonly kept in the LJ, that is the Lomstein-Jensen medium. Okay, it's commonly kept in a McCartney bottle, 30 ml, and it contains the following ingredients: potassium dihydrogen phosphate, magnesium sulfate, magnesium citrate, asparagine, glycerol, 2% Mg, and also eggs. Okay, 2% Mg is malachite green. Okay, so that a whole lot of ingredients, and these ingredients will be asked in your Viva as well. Okay. Also, we can use Dorset egg medium, Petragnini medium, and the ATS medium, that is the American Thoracic Society medium. Okay. Now, the non-egg containing medium are the Loeffler's medium, non-egg containing solid media, that is. It contains serum, Pawlowski medium, which contains potato, Tarshi's medium, which contains blood, and this Middlebrook 7H9 and 7H12, which contain agar. Okay. Now, with respect to culture, it's important to note the differential findings of Mycobacterium tuberculosis sensu stricto and Mycobacterium bovis. Okay, so Mycobacterium tuberculosis will give rough, tough and buff colonies when cultured, whereas Mycobacterium bovis will give smooth, shiny and white colonies. However, now I want all of you to go back to your textbooks and look up the complete list of differences between M. bovis and MTB. Okay. So it's a complete list. There are chemical differences, culture differences, microscopic appearance differences. So you have to memorize all of them. Okay, I'm not discussing over here, but you should go and read that up as well. Okay. Now the liquid media. The liquid media which we have are Middlebrook 7H. Sorry, I must have made a mistake over here. It's not 7H9. It's 7H10. At 7H11. Okay. Next, we move on to. Wait. Yeah, sorry about that. The Middlebrook 7H10 or 11 are the non-egg containing solid media. Okay, sorry for the mistake. And the Middlebrook 7H9 and 12 are the liquid medium. Okay. So the other liquid media are the Dubose media, the Sulas medium, the Sutton's medium, and the Proskar and Beck's medium. Okay, we need to remember that the growth is faster on liquid medium. Okay, and over here, if I just zoom this up a bit, when you're culturing it on a liquid media, you'll see that first there will be formation of the surface pellicle, okay, and then you'll see these serpentine cords inside. These are forming due to something, a virulence factor of MTBE, which is known as a cord factor. Its chemical composition is 6663 halodemicolate. Need not remember that, but you should remember that it is important for intracellular survival of the bacilli. Okay, so you should remember that. So over here we have the rapid diagnostic test. So these rapid diagnostic tests are very important nowadays, because these are the most which are the most commonly being used tests in our laboratories, even in our medical college laboratories. The first is this BACTEC 460 TB. Okay, this is the machine. It's an automated technique where we are using radio labeled palmitic acid. Okay, and the culture media is the Middlebrook 7H12. Okay, and of course this is the liquid medium, so it offers a very faster result. Okay, next we use this mycobacterial growth indicator tube. Okay, it's an automated fluorometric method, and it uses oxygen sensitive fluorescent compound, which is known as ruthenium, which is embedded at the bottom of the Middlebrook 7H12 tube. Okay, and the third is this Bacti Alert, which is a colorimetric method. Again, the culture media is MB7H12, and it uses a gas permeable sensor, which changes color from dark green to bright yellow when we are producing carbon dioxide. Over here also, this radio labeled palmitic acid, the importance is that this will be used by the bacilli to produce carbon dioxide, and hence the carbon dioxide will also be radio labeled, and from that we can make a scintillation counter we use, and we make a diagnosis as to the presence or absence of the bacilli. Okay, and of course over here this is the MGIT, is a mycobacterial growth indicator tube, is placed in this machine, and then this is the Bacti Alert. Okay, so this Bacti Alert is found in, is present in our medical college laboratory as well, in the microbiology department. Okay, so now let's finally move on to the molecular methods. These will have the maximum sensitivity, and the various techniques are used, like PCR, polymerase chain reaction, LCR, ligase chain reaction, TMA, transcription mediated amplification, SDA, real-time PCR. Okay, but disadvantage again is that it cannot differentiate between dead and live bacilli, because it's just detecting the genome. Okay, it's not detecting whether it's actively it's in an active metabolic state. Okay, and the most common target of the nucleic acid probes is this insertion sequence 6110. In short form, it's called IS6110. Why? Because it's repeated more than 20 times in the MTBE genome. We can also use something known as the expert MTBE RIF assay. Okay, expert gene assay. So over here we did simultaneously detect the presence of Mycobacterium tuberculosis bacilli, and we detect whether it's rifampicin resistant or not in a time frame of less than 2 hours. The rifampicin assay is done using by using nucleic acid probes against this, the RPOB gene. Okay, RPOB gene mutation confers rifampicin resistance to the bacilli. One more technique is known as the microscopic observation of drug susceptibility, also known as MODS, which detects the presence of viable bacilli and performs susceptibility testing for both rifampicin and INH. Okay, so by this we can accurately classify whether a bacilli is MDR-TB or not, that is multi-drug resistant or not, using a single test. However, again, it's a little time consuming because it takes 5 to 10 days to get the result. Okay, so let's move on to a few of the serological tests. The basis behind these serological tests is that these are the APC cells, okay, the antigen presenting cells, which will be presenting the tuberculin antigen to the memory T cells, okay. So when we are giving a tuberculin antigen or anything of that sort, when the APC will present it to the memory T cells, and there will be release of these chemokines, TNF-alpha, interferon gamma, interleukin 8, which will cause erythema and induration. The serological tests are aimed at finding and detecting these interferon gamma levels, and also the presence of erythema and induration on the skin. So the first test, the most famous test, is the Mantoux test or the Purkett test. Purkett, whatever. We give intradermal injection of 5 units of PPD of CBOT, that is purified protein derivative of CBOT, and the results are read after 48 to 72 hours. Now, there will be an induration, and the diameter of the induration is very important to make a diagnosis. Now, if it is less than 5 mm, then it's considered negative in all cases. If it is between 5 to 10 millimeters, it's considered positive only in HIV patients, in known contacts of tuberculosis, and in organ transplantation patients. Okay. If the diameter of induration is between 10 to 15 millimeters, it's considered positive in HIV negative sex workers, homosexuals, commercial sex workers, healthcare workers, and if in children less than 4 years of age. Okay. And finally, if it's more than 15 millimeters, it's considered positive in all cases. Again, this Mantoux test has a disadvantage that it is positive even 4 to 6 weeks after a routine vaccination. Okay. And it offers no distinction between active and latent cases. Okay, so that's a very big disadvantage of the Mantoux test. Now we move on to the interferon gamma release assays. These are of two types. One is the ELISpot or T-spot TB, and the other is the QuantiFERON TB golden tube. In ELISpot, both techniques are essentially the same. In ELISpot, we use the peripheral blood nucleus cells and we expose it to a mixture of synthetic peptides ESAT6 and CFP10. I hope you remember what are these things. That is the early secretory antigen 6 and the CFP10, that is the culture filtered protein 10, which I discussed in the pathogenesis of tuberculosis. Okay. So we count the number of interferon gamma spots produced. Okay. But however, the disadvantage is that sometimes it's positive for other mycobacteria as well. The QuantiFERON TB golden tube, on the other hand, in addition to CFP10 and ESAT6, we give this TB7.7, which is surface protein. Okay, and ELISA, via ELISA, we measure the amount of interferon gamma produced. The advantage over Mantoux is that these are more specific and are unaffected by previous BCG vaccination and require only one visit. Okay, but it cannot distinguish between active and latent infection. So this disadvantage is still there. So these are the latest diagnostic modalities. It's not present in all the textbooks as well, and these are not very commonly used all over the world as well. However, these are offering newer methods to provide accurate diagnosis within a short period of time with only one visit. Okay, the first of these is the MPB64 patch test. Over here, we use a mycobacterial protein fraction from BCG64, which is just tuberculosis complex specific exocrine protein. It is an immunochromatographic based test where we use anti-BCG64 monoclonal antibodies. Okay, and it can differentiate between active and latent infections. We read this after 3 to 4 days, and it has 100% specificity and a 98.1% sensitivity as well. So here you can see these patches being applied on the skin. Okay, these are like those nicotine patches. So we apply them on the skin, and after 3 to 4 days, the patient can report himself whether the patch has appeared or not, a spot has appeared or not. Or we can use this lipoarabinomannan assay from the urine. I hope you remember whether lipoarabinomannan is present in the cell wall. It's a highly sensitive and specific test. However, its diagnostic accuracy is restricted to patients whose CD4 counts are less than 40 per microliters. So we can use them in AIDS patients, but in normal immunocompetent individuals, this is not a very good test. Okay. So this is the final slide, and over here we'll be discussing the RNTCP guidelines for diagnosis of pediatric tuberculosis and adult tuberculosis. So when will you suspect a case of pulmonary tuberculosis? If there has been persistent fever for the past 2 weeks without a known cause, or there has been unremitting cough for more than 2 weeks, and/or weight loss of 5% in 3 months, or no weight gain in the past 3 months. So any of these three criteria are satisfied, we suspect a case of pulmonary tuberculosis. So this is a bit small. Let's just zoom up a bit. Yeah. So what we first do is that we do a CBNAT. CBNAT is a cartridge-based nucleic acid amplification test. Okay. We generally use that gene expert protocol only. So if after CBNAT, we can have two possible outcomes. That is, we have detected the MTB or we haven't. So if we have detected the MTB, it's a microbiologically confirmed TB case. If MTB is not detected, then we have to move on. One thing we have to remember, that if CBNAT is not available, then we should do smear microscopy. Okay, so again, if smear microscopy comes out to be true, then it's a microbiologically confirmed TB case. Now, if MTB is not detected or sputum is not available, whichever be the case, we have to do an X-ray, and also we have to do a TST. What is TST? A tuberculin sensitivity test. Now we can have four possible outcomes from this. The four possible outcomes is that one is that the chest X-ray is highly suggestive of TB. In that case, what we'll do is that we'll do a gastric aspirate, or we'll do an induced sputum sample. We'll get an induced sputum sample, and on that we'll do a CBNAT. If that comes out to be true or positive, then it's a microbiologically confirmed TB case. If it still comes out to be negative, and we find that there are no other likely alternative diagnosis, then we label this as a clinically diagnosed TB case. If chest X-ray shadows are non-specific and the TST is negative, then we'll give a course of antibiotics. Okay. And after the course, if persistent shadow and symptoms are present, then we have to do a gastric aspirate or induced sputum. If it is positive, then it's again a microbiologically confirmed case, and it's negative, then we have to refer it to an expert for workup of persistent pneumonia. Next, if the chest X-ray is normal and the TST is positive, then we have to evaluate for EPTB, that is extrapulmonary tuberculosis, and refer to an expert. Finally, if the chest X-ray is normal and the TST is negative, then we have to look for alternative cause. Okay. Over here, one thing they have not mentioned is that chest X-ray is highly suggestive and TST is positive as well. Okay. So we follow this protocol. But this TST positive, even if it doesn't come, if the X-ray chest is highly suggestive, we still follow this protocol. Okay. Next, we move on to the adult TB protocol. So we have a presumptive TB patient, that is one who presents with evening rise of temperature, night sweats for a long duration of time. So this presumptive TB case will do two things. One is a smear examination, and another is this chest X-ray. If the smear is positive and the chest X-ray is highly suggestive of tuberculosis, then it's a microbiologically confirmed TB case. Okay. No, there's no two way of this out of this. Okay. If the smear is positive but the chest X-ray is not suggestive of TB, it's still a microbiologically confirmed TB case. If the smear is negative but the chest x-ray is suggestive of TB, then we do a CBNAT. If the smear is negative or not available and chest x-ray is not suggestive of TB or not available, then if we have a high clinical suspicion, we still go for the CBNAT. One more thing, in an HIV patient, if you are suspecting permanent tuberculosis, we don't go through the smear examination and chest x-ray. We straight away jump to CBNAT. Next, in CBNAT, if MTB is detected, then we have to determine whether it's rifampicin sensitive, indeterminate or resistant. And if MTB is not detected or result not available, then we have to consider alternate diagnosis or refer to a specialist. We can label it as a clinically diagnosed TB case, or we have to go for an alternative diagnosis. Now, if it's rifampicin sensitive, then we'll label it as a microbiologically confirmed TB case. If it comes out to be rifampicin indeterminate, then we have to repeat the CBNAT on another sample. And if it's still indeterminate, then we have to go for culture. And if it comes out to be rifampicin resistant, then we have to refer it to a specialist for management of rifampicin resistant. All presumptive TB cases should be offered HIV counseling and testing. However, diagnostic workup for TB must not be delayed. So with this, we end the RNTCP guidelines. We must remember these, and it's very commonly asked in your exams as well. And if you write this, it's surely going to form a very positive impression on your examiner as well. So with this, we come to this long module, the end of this long module. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you.